live. Tom Niemann, along with Jason and Dara.
Woo.
About halfway through.
Halfway through the football season already. We always say, can you believe it? But you know what? I can believe it. And some of these teams are starting to show that midseason form.
All right, our Game of the Week viewer's choice is the first order of business tonight. Yes. You can vote right now up until about 11 o'clock tonight, 10:55 to be exact. These are next week's games in South Dakota. We would go out. The winner, whoever wins this voting, will go out, shoot the game, and it will be aired on September 28th.
Pierre just played a thriller tonight. Yankton played a thriller tonight. Harrisburg looking good in AA. Brandon Valley with a huge showing, so a lot of good choices. And you have the right to vote, so... go exercise.
Get on Twitter or Facebook and go do it, and that'll be good. Both those games should be very good. Let's get to the scoreboard in North Dakota tonight, Jandy. And there was one really big upset we will get to, but we start with West Fargo, the number one team in North Dakota in everybody's mind, I think, right now, and they beat Cheyenne 26-0 tonight. West Fargo's 4-0 on the season.
Pretty clear that West Fargo is the best team. Can't wait to check out those highlights.
Legacy and Bismarck will play on Saturday, and we will have a preview of this game coming up a little bit later in the show. Minot, this is the upset of the night, I think, in most people's minds, Jandy. 28-10 over Century.
Yeah, the writers had Century, I think, at number two. I didn't check. Two or three in the poll, and Minot definitely belongs in that top five as well. But you thought on the road they would really struggle against the Patriots, who looked really good. Well, they found a few weaknesses, so we'll find out exactly what those weaknesses are in the highlights.
All right, Grand Forks Central had lost 19 games in a row. Is that correct?
That is correct. And they busted through. You had the feeling they would do it this year at some point. Fargo North had just gotten their first win of the season last week, and now the Knights off to Schneid this week.
All right, Fargo South gets to 2-2 with a win over Grand Forks Red River, 20-14. We'll take a look at that one coming up later. Also highlights from Dickinson and Mandan as Dickinson goes to 3-1 on the season. It was Williston over Jamestown tonight, 28-7. Williston evens out at 2-2 on the season. Fargo Davies and Devil's Lake will play on Saturday. A couple of the top quarterbacks in the EDC going at it in that one with Ethan Mathson and Jacob Mertens for Devil's Lake, and that game will be Saturday. In 2A in North Dakota tonight, Bismarck St. Mary's and Turtle Mountain, that game on Saturday as well. Dickinson Trinity over Valley City tonight, first loss of the season for Valley City.
Hard to make sense of AA right now. You've got St. Mary's, who's been playing phenomenally, and then the Highlanders I thought were just a fraction behind, but look at this. Dickinson Trinity, who was earlier in the power poll, now beats the number two team. Now we got to take another look at them, and Kindred just dominating in this class so far, so... yeah, it's starting to thin out here. I think we've got some really powerful teams in the mix.
All right, Trinity gets to 3-1 with that win tonight in Class A in North Dakota. A little shocker here, maybe, as Larimore wipes out Park River Fordville Lankin 40-0.
Not a shocker they won, but a 40-0 win. This is a huge winning streak for Park River that came to an end, and looking forward to the highlights in that one.
Minot Bishop Ryan gets to 4-0, 37-12 over Velvet Sawyer tonight, or Velvet Sawyer, as I heard tonight. Might go with that instead, but Bishop Ryan still undefeated in Class A. Nine man in North Dakota, a couple of games you're keeping an eye on, Jandy. Thompson, the number one team there over North Star, 56-6, and then Shiloh Christian gets to 5-0 with that win tonight.
Yeah, nine man football, always interesting to see who's going to be in that mix, and it looks like right now, Thompson, every time we check on their score, they are the team to beat.
All right, again, highlights coming up from many of those games tonight. We got highlights from 15 games in North Dakota and South Dakota, including that Minot win over Bismarck Century coming up. In South Dakota, scores tonight in the big schools. It was Roosevelt over Harrisburg. That's 3A against 2A, but Harrisburg led 14-13 at one point, and then Roosevelt romped them from there.
Yeah, in case you're wondering, you see the two number one rankings. That's not a mistake.
Different classes.
And yeah, this one maybe didn't tell the whole story by the score, so we'll take a deeper look at that one in the highlights.
Sioux Falls Washington gets to 4-0 as they pull away from O'Gorman later in this game.
Yeah, this one again, 14-14 at halftime, and Washington just outlasted them in the second half.
Brandon Valley rebounds. About everybody for them scores tonight. 49-20 over Rapid City Stevens. We'll take a look at that one. Sioux Falls Lincoln goes to Brookings and keeps the Bobcats winless so far. 27-7 is the final in that one. Aberdeen Central and Yankton played a great game tonight in Aberdeen. Yankton scored with about 7 minutes to go on a fumble recovery by Oakley Palmer in the end zone to go up 20-18. Cannon Hannigan scored a touchdown with 33 seconds left to win it for Aberdeen Central.
Yeah, that makes Yankton 1-3, folks. I mean, they got off to a subpar year last year and still came back and won the title. They're going to have to do the same thing this year, maybe even to a greater extent.
All right, Watertown evens out at 2-2 with a win out at Rapid City Central tonight, 18-14. We'll take a look at that one. Mitchell was up 41-0 at halftime on Sturgis, and the Colonels going to win that one 68-8.
Yeah, Spencer Negebauer had 7 touchdowns coming into this game. Well, he added, 4 more in this one, 3 rushing, 90 yards, a receiving touchdown. By the way, Drew Kitchens, 11 catches, 140 yards in the touchdown. So, yeah, they rolled over the Scoopers.
Huron and Pierre were tied at 13 at halftime. They were tied at 27 at the end of regulation. Hudson Rohrbach with a touchdown for Pierre to put him up in overtime. Huron scores on a Tyler Lean touchdown to get within a point. They go for 2 and don't get it, and Pierre wins in overtime.
We did talk to Jeff Duffy, who announced that game for Huron, and we're going to have him on in the zone coverage. Even though we didn't have highlights, this game was such a thriller. We're going to talk to him about that decision at the end of the game.
Highland Hines, 2 more touchdown runs, 2 more touchdown passes for Huron in that one. Spearfish is 3-0 as they beat Douglas tonight. Spearfish at Mitchell coming up next week. Madison, Josh Giles had almost 300 yards passing and 4 touchdowns
again
in the first half of this game as Madison wins 53-7. St. Thomas More in 11B tonight, 66-16. Went over Lee Deadwood.
Yeah, St. Thomas More. I mean, we talk so much about Madison in this class, but St. Thomas More has had a fantastic season right on their heels. They're not going to be able to play Madison. We're not going to know who's the best, but I have a feeling these two teams will make a deep run into part of November.
Sioux Falls Christian is 4-0 now after a win over Sioux Valley tonight.
Congratulations to Sioux Valley, first team to score more than 1 touchdown against Sioux Falls Christian this year. We'll look at the highlights of that one in a little bit.
Highlights as well from T-Area's win over Del Rapids. T-Area is 4-0.
Wow, 4-0 and a shutout. This was a huge test for them. We just did a piece on our weekly show about the surprise teams across high school football. This was my most surprising team in South Dakota, and they surprised once again.
Valentine, Nebraska plays in Class C2 down in Nebraska. The lowest 11-man class, but their enrollment almost dead even with Winter, but Winter beats them 48-0.
And by the way, Valentine came into this
3-0. Yeah.
So these huge wins that Winter are getting throughout the season, they really become more and more impressive, and that's 4 shutouts in a row for the Warriors.
Winter beats a good team tonight to get to 4-0. In 9B, Jandy, Langford over to Smet, 40-12. Langford is 4-0, and Woolsey Wessington is 4-0 in 9AA with a win over Hitchcock Tulare.
Just keeping an eye on some of the best 9-man teams in South Dakota. Langford's Lincoln Gibbs, who's going on to play at USD, did not play in tonight's game. They still got the big win. And Woolsey Wessington, no problem. So those are the two teams I'm looking at as probably the best teams in 9-man football right now.
All right, first game up in the highlights tonight, Jason, is Minot at Bismarck Century.
Let's get into it.
Rematch of the big school championship last year in North Dakota. Who did you think coming into this one was going to get it done?
Well, I really thought Century had been more impressive in the first 3 weeks of the season than Minot had. But give credit to Creighton Rudolph. This guy keeps getting better and better, and he has some of the best array of receivers in the state to throw to. This is just one example.
Yeah, look what happens here, though. Brett Lundy makes the catch. They fumble it. Lofton Klabundy picks it up for a touchdown, and Minot's up 7-3. And then this is the last play of the first half. Rudolph, Lundy grabs it and hangs on this time, 14-3 at halftime.
Love receivers that you can trust. You can high point the ball and know that they're going to have the best chance to come down with it. Lundy's been doing that all season long.
Century with a touchdown here, as it will get it to Simons to go up. It's 21-10 at that point. Manuel Bradford had a big second half in this game for Minot. He scores a touchdown, big run in the second half. It ends up in a Creighton Rudolph to Klabundy touchdown. So Lofton Klabundy, 2 touchdowns for Minot tonight. The Magicians win it 28-10, and Minot is 3-1.
Huge win for Minot. That puts them back into the contender column in the AAA class in North Dakota right now. Not that Century is eliminated from that contender column, but it really puts the rest of the WDA on notice. A really tough region right now, and it just goes to show anybody can win in these big school WDA battles.
All right, Minot 2-0 in the region. Let's go to Fargo, and it was West Fargo taking on West Fargo Cheyenne, and it was cloudy and wet and rainy. And that is
that's some leaping ability
for Wes Fargo in the introductions, the North Dakota State commit. Scoreless first quarter. This is the second. Chase Tyken with a touchdown. I believe that was his ninth of the season. And then they go to the air. Andy Gravdahl to Joe Pistorius, who is having quite a season.
There is your story of the game, folks. Chase Tyken has done so much of the legwork, but tonight, Andy Gravdahl just keeps it rocking with Joe Pistorius.
Got it down to the one-yard line, and then Tyken again, his second of the game, 10th touchdown on the ground of the season for Tyken, and it's 12-0 West Fargo in the lead. And then Cheyenne, a little defense, big hit by Hayden Reynolds.
He's a big-time player, by the way. Yeah. He's getting looks at colleges all across the region.
All right, a couple plays later, though, they go back to the air, and Pistorius wide open. Gravdahl finds him again. 20-0 West Fargo at halftime. And the big boys, these guys have been around a while. Cheyenne, one of the new teams up there, and the big boy, the old boy showing them what's going on here. And
oh, nice grab that time, taking it right out of the air. But again, credit to the quarterback, the junior quarterback, Andy Gravdahl, rolling to his left, completing it to his right. This time, he's able to set up in the pocket with plenty of time. He always has plenty of time in the pocket, and finds another receiver for a touchdown. An outstanding night for Pistorius and Gravdahl.
All right, according to our man, Fuzz Ahmet, that was foreshadowing of Sam Bradford to Stephon Diggs on Sunday for the Vikings.
Is that it?
The Gravdahl to Pistorius connection.
Great analysis.
26-0 West Fargo, and the Packers are 4-0. They are at Grand Forks Red River. Two more touchdowns for Tyken, and then you got Gravdahl going to Pistorius.
Yeah, we had to talk to Joe Pistorius after this game to get his emotions on playing the Crosstown Rivals.
We knew right away that it was rainy and it was going to be tough to throw the ball, but we came out here, we settled it down right away and tried to try it a little bit, and it ended up working out a little bit. But Chase is a great guy and a great running back. When you ever need him to score a touchdown or get some yards for us, he really does it for us. We used to go to school with him, they used to be our little buddies, but now it's kind of bittersweet getting to play him a little more and win against him. But we got to take every team by the same standards, and we did that tonight.
Yeah, they beat him up a little bit. 26-0 the final there.
Little statement, you know. These guys played together. They've known each other, you know, their whole school career. And another good point that Joe makes is they have Chase Tyken, who really sets up the balance on this offense, that they can run the ball whenever they want to, which opens up the pass game, takes a little pressure off of the quarterback, and you can put a junior quarterback in, and he can make plays like that.
All right, West Fargo keeps it rolling. Let's go to Mandan, Jandy. It's homecoming in Mandan. You got the band, and you got some brats grilling out there, and you got the teams coming on. Mandan looking for its first
football,
win
by the way. This is what football
the season. It was a beautiful night out on the river. Dickinson, though, takes care of business. Sean Steffen to Annan Moody for a connection here.
Love Sean Steffen. This guy has really taken control of this offense this year, and you saw him do it through with the arm. He can do it with the legs. He's got a lot of good receivers on this team. Dickinson is another team in the WDA to watch out for.
And then the touchdown here for Dickinson is big man Trevin Hopfuff.
Hopfuff.
I'm sure I'm pronouncing that correctly, but yeah. It's a touchdown, 7-0. Dickinson in the lead. Mandan comes up with a stop right here, but did not do it enough tonight. You're going to get Steffen to Moody again here for a touchdown to make it 14-0.
I mean, most of you know Adam Moody is a great basketball player, but this guy gets it done catching the ball, and this year he's really taken that another step up. One of the best receivers in all of Class AAA.
All right, we're going to get a completion and a fumble. And Quinn Halstengard is going to take that the other way for Mandan for a touchdown to make it a 14-7 game. So the Braves are hanging in there on homecoming. But just before the half, the connection to Moody again for another touchdown.
Yeah, he was too much trouble, just too much speed down the field. And Mandan needed some more plays like they got on defense there, because their offense has really struggled to get a rhythm this year, and it starts at the quarterback position and flows the rest of the way down. They're going to improve as this season goes on, but they are not close to where they were last year.
Yeah, they are. Mandan 0-4 on the season, and does not get any easier for them as they go to Minot next week. Dickinson, meanwhile, is 3-1, Jandy. And
just
got
the
a
one loss to Bismarck.
Yeah, Jamestown coming up next week. All right, in Grand Forks tonight, it was Fargo South on the road at Grand Forks Red River.
Both these teams needed a huge win, some type of momentum going their way. And early on, at least, it was Fargo South grabbing some of that momentum.
Ben Bryant with the interception off the tip there. And then Jacque Pfeiffer to Tanner Beaton. That's the first touchdown connection of the season for these guys.
Yeah, and we all know Beaton is one of their main guys and main targets for the Bruins. And it's good to see those guys connecting.
Red River's Carlos Martin to the outside, 40 yards for the touchdown to tie it at 7.
Pure speed. That's just give it to him. Spread him out on the outside. Let him beat his man.
All right, it was raining all over in North Dakota tonight. Made things a little sloppy there, but Matt Laternis punches it in there. Red River is up 14-7. And then the next possession here, and that's another Fargo South interception, this one by Victor Isaac.
Yeah,
sets up a Jamon
creating.
Howard touchdown here to tie it up with 14.
Defense creating offense, and this is a team that used to make their identity running the ball. This year, with Pfeiffer, they're really able to throw the ball down the field. Even on wet conditions like this, they're really, really much smoother in the passing game.
All right, third quarter here, still tied up. Pfeiffer to Victor Isaac there, and then Pfeiffer. And that is his man again, Howard, for the game-winning touchdown. And Fargo South goes up to Grand Forks and beats Red River 20-14.
Huge win for the Bruins, who hadn't won since opening night. Get back into that win column with the road win against the Rough Riders.
Both of these teams now 2-2 on the season, and Grand Forks Red River has to go to West Fargo coming up next week. All right, Class A in North Dakota, Jason. And this
is
Minot Bishop Ryan at Velva Sawyer. This is the Copper Bowl. And here is Bishop Ryan. Cole Dafanias, 40 yards for the touchdown to put Minot Bishop Ryan up 7-0.
Yeah, Ryan had played Class AA a couple years ago. Have moved down to A. Didn't have a great season last year playing in A, but this year feels like they really are starting to gel.
Elijah Hackman on the catch and carry there for Velvis Sawyer. That's good for 15 yards. And the Nick efforts will go to Hayden Lee here, Janda. They get a long gain, but this drive would stall out and they would not get any points out of it.
Yeah, that Bishop Ryan defense, bend but don't break, gave up the big play. But when it got into the red zone, they took care of business.
All right, a little defense here. Jordan Will with the sack. And then Velvis Sawyer, though, comes right back here. They do get on the scoreboard. Efforts
nice.
To Hunter Brabant
nice.
For a touchdown.
That is nice, yeah. They got one highlight to take away from this game. Maybe not the win, but great play that time.
Bishop Ryan slips 7-6, and then this is Dafanias again. Little cut to the outside, 80 yards, gone for the touchdown. Made a 13-6 Bishop Ryan at halftime.
One guy can make so much difference just by making that move. And his quickness has really vaulted this team to be, I think, a contender in Class A. A class that's really open at the top. We're going to see some other Class A contenders later, but you got to keep the Bishop Ryan Lions in that conversation.
Break it open in the second half, 37-12. So Bishop Ryan now 4-0 on the season in Class A. Another game in Class A, North Dakota tonight, Jandy, is a beautiful rain coming down. As you got Larimore at 3-0, Park River, Fordville, Lankin at 3-0.
23-0 in their last 23 games. Hadn't lost since 2014 against this Polar Bear team. And this is a little different Polar Bear team than a couple years ago. They got Royce Verkulin.
Verkulin, 25 yards there, 6-0 Larimore. And then he does it again from 5 yards out, and Larimore up 12-0 in the first quarter.
He's had a couple 200-yard rushing games this year. This backfield, by the way, for Larimore, their top three running backs, they average 9 yards per carry this year, and they can throw the ball. Look at Jacob Tupa there.
20-0 Larimore midway through the second quarter. And then a little defense out of Larimore here. This is Monte Hendrickson with the interception.
Jackson Hankey, their main workhorse last year, running back, has moved to quarterback. You see him right there, just not used to playing quarterback, and gets one tipped.
Hendricks has got some beef. Guy. He got the interception and then gets the touchdown. Larimore up 26-0, and they win 40-0 tonight, Jandy.
This was a dominant performance by the Polar Bears. The Writers' Poll had these guys 1-2, and the Polar Bears proved there's a big difference between these two teams.
Verkulin, 223 yards, 3 touchdowns
wow.
in this game for Larimore, as the Polar Bears are now 4-0 on the season in Class A. Nine-man football in North Dakota. You got Linton HMB at Shiloh Christian. Homecoming for Shiloh Christian. They are 4-0 on the season coming into this game.
Oh, nice.
And a little hook and ladder. for Shiloh Christian, showing off early. Linton comes back here, though. Cole Baumiller to Jared Baumiller on the receiving end. Nice grab for a big gain there. And then Jack McCrory is going to take it in for the first touchdown for Linton HMB.
Yeah, they were able to spread it around a little bit, and they had upset on the mind. Linton has always has a good team, and just when you think that they're maybe down a little bit, they usually will snap up and play a good game. But we also forget the Shiloh Christian team. They're a contender in the state as a nine-man squad, and I don't forget about the Skyhawks.
Cannon Fagerland with a good run there, and then this is Cody Grease breaking loose for a touchdown. And after Linton scored that first touchdown, Shiloh took over from there.
Yeah, this is a team that has really grown over the past few years, and now they feel like a contender year in and year out. Doesn't matter who graduates, they have great players to fill the holes.
Landon Twardski, I believe, there on the run and the touchdown.
And the Lions punch one in, and the Skyhawks kept answering. And look at that. They pull away 44-20 with the win. Skyhawks stay undefeated. And they're in that conversation with the elite teams, along with Thompson and a couple others in nine-man football.
All right, Shiloh Christian at 5-0 in the nine-man ranks in North Dakota. So go back to that Minot-Bismarck Century game one more time. Minot knocks off Bismarck Century 28-10.
Yeah, that's the biggest statement game of the night. And like I said, the WDA is on notice right now that Minot is a team to be considered. And right now the West looks a lot stronger than the East, even though you have West Fargo out in the East. I think as a whole, the West is a lot deeper.
Really?
Oh, right. Dickinson, Bismarck, Century, Minot, they're all looking really good right now.
All right. So is West Fargo. All right.
Well, they are. But one team, four teams.
All right.
You get it, depth.
More from North Dakota coming up later in zone coverage. We'll get some reaction from those games tonight. We move on to South Dakota coming up next. Highlights from Rapid City and Sioux Falls and all over. Brandon Valley runs up big numbers tonight. We've got South Dakota highlights when we come back.
Varsity Sports Live on Midco Sports Network is presented by Farmers Union Insurance Agency and South Dakota State University.
And welcome back to Varsity Sports Live on another Football Friday in South Dakota and North Dakota. Let's get to South Dakota's highlights. And Sioux Falls, Washington, Jandy was taking on Sioux Falls, O'Gorman tonight. Washington, the defending big school state champions, didn't know what they were going to have this year. Tons of young players on this team, but they looked good against O'Gorman tonight. Sean Aromo with a touchdown early for Washington.
That's his fifth touchdown, by the way, in the last 3 weeks for the senior running back, one of the few seniors on this offense. But huge play right here. Nick Billion catches a long pass. They call that a fumble. Jack Brenn gets on top of it, and they capitalize with this nice. Look at that. 1 foot in. That's all you need.
Jaden Johansson, the sophomore quarterback. That's Logan UTech. Touchdown. Just a junior is UTech. 14-0, but O'Gorman comes back. Hunter Thompson with a touchdown.
Yeah, they benefited off of a few penalties, scored on this drive. And then look at this one. The block by Nick Billion. Canyon Bauer, I think he was on the plate, the field almost every play in the first half, including special teams, picks it up for the scoop and score.
Bauer makes it 14-14 at halftime. And then this is one of the best catches we've seen so far this season by UTech.
Yeah, Jaden Johansson says he sees this all the time in practice, but we don't get to see it very often. Logan UTech stretching out for this one. Left-handed, yes. And he sticks it. Look at that. That was on fourth down, by the way. Fourth and one, and they skied it out to him and then capped the drive later with this Jaden Johansson sneak up the middle.
92-yard drive. Johansson makes it 21-14. Johansson went to Thurl Reisdorfer for a 60-yard touchdown, and then Tupac Kepea finished it off with a 32-yard touchdown run late in the game. 35-14, Washington is 4-0 on the season.
Yeah, they maybe didn't play their best game of the year, but they still keep getting scores like this, even though they're not playing perfect games. I did catch up with Jaden Johansson right after the game and got his reaction.
Well, it was a hyped-up game, and they came out hot, and we were out a little bit flat, and we brought it in the second half, and that's where we beat them in the second half. We decided we were going to come out with more intensity. Like, we were flat in the first half. We wanted to come out with more intensity and just bring it to them and pound the football.
They did pound that football in the second half and played some excellent defense.
But they got a lot of speed, too. All those good Washington teams in the last 5 or 6 years have had a lot of speed, and they do this year, too.
And they're all sophomores and juniors, pretty much all. I mean, you got Sean Aromo, but after that, ton of youth on this team, and they are really overachieving early in the season as far as I'm concerned.
All right. Another really good team from Sioux Falls is Roosevelt. The Riders at home tonight. A little sneak peek at the score there. But Harrisburg came into this one 3-0 in double-A. Roosevelt has Torin Devricks, though, who can throw it and run it. He scores the first two touchdowns on the ground.
Yeah, he started to run it in the last couple weeks, and he's getting some touchdowns with his feet. But this Harrisburg team is a good second-half team. And they got a touchdown or two in the first half as well.
Hunter Headley from 13 yards made it 13-7. And then Sam Lose from 8 yards here. And Harrisburg leads 14-13.
Roosevelt was keyed on shutting down Jack Anderson. Lose gets the carry and gets one in, though.
All right, this is Nathan Varnes, though.
What a night.
The sideline cuts it in. This is going to go 80 yards. This came after a 72-yard touchdown connection for the Rough Riders. That made it 28-14. Devricks added another touchdown run. Tyson Jan with a late touchdown run. 41-21 is the final.
Yeah, I saw some unofficial stats. I think Varnes even had more than that. He had over 200 yards receiving. Devricks threw for over 400 yards passing. And this Rough Rider team, even though it was close at halftime, really found that accelerator button.
Yeah, Varnes had the 72-yard touchdown and the 80-yard touchdown. The Riders are 4-0, and they go out to Rapid City Stevens. Harrisburg, another good test next week at Brandon Valley. In Brookings tonight, Jandy, at Dana J. Dykhouse Stadium. You got Sioux Falls Lincoln taking on Brookings. The Bobcats still looking for their first win of the season. Second quarter here, and this is Cole DeBerg with a big run for the Patriots.
Cole DeBerg switched from receiver to quarterback, and he gives you two dimensions. He can run and he can pass, and you see it right there. He got it going, and guess who finishes it off? The big boy, Corey Fichter.
Fichter, bowling ball banging in. 7-0 Lincoln. Later in the second quarter, though, Fichter picked off by Devin Coughlin, and he runs it back to give Brookings a first and goal on the return.
Yeah, the Brookings defense had to keep them in this one because offensively, they've been challenged in the last couple weeks, but they did find a way to punch it in and got it tied up at halftime.
Nick Harden to Brennan Carlson for the touchdown there, tied up 7-7.
Nick Harden, by the way, came in to play quarterback in the middle of last week, and he's really stuck there now since he gave him a little spark last week against Douglas.
It's over for Coughlin. That touchdown there by Trent Nas was called back. It was 7-7 at halftime in this game, and then Lincoln rolls in the second half to win it 27-7, so the Patriots are now 2-2 on the season.
Yeah, Nas did have one called back, but then he got one again in the third quarter, and Sioux Falls Lincoln, after a little test in the first half, found some breathing room and got their second win of the year.
A couple of good games coming up next week as well with Lincoln at Aberdeen Central, and Brookings will go to Huron. Out in Rapid City tonight, Jan, you got Rapid City Central on homecoming, taking on Watertown. Both these teams coming in at 1-2 on the season. And the Arrows had blocked a punt, put them in good field goal position. They get the first touchdown of the game.
Yeah, this Watertown team is so much different when they have Alex Gower at quarterback. And last week we saw him back, and he made them more competitive against the Mitchell team. And this week he did the same. He kept them in this game.
Arrows up 6-0. This is Jaleel Snipes for Rapid City Central. And he gets run down at the 15-yard line there, but he takes it in a couple plays later for the touchdown. Cobbler's up 7-6.
Yeah, give him another dose of Snipes. He got in. Caleb Walton Blandon had one, but the Arrows get enough in the end to pull out to a win.
Watertown had a 12-7 lead at the half. The Arrows go to 2-2 on the season, and they come down and play Sioux Falls O'Gorman next week. And Rapid City Central 1-3 now on the season, and they've got a test against Sioux Falls Washington coming up next week. Let's go out to Brandon, South Dakota. Got Rapid City Stevens in town to take on Brandon Valley, who lost last week to O'Gorman. I saw this, that Brandon Valley is 5-0 under Chad Garrow the week after they lose to Sioux Falls O'Gorman. So,
hey,
there
so
you go.
Money in the bank.
First play of the game there, Stevens with a fumble. Riley Schmeling recovers, and then the offense takes off. Cade Trevier, 24 yards for a touchdown, 7-0, and then Trevier again here to make it 14-0.
Yeah, don't let Trevier's size fool you. He's a big, strong running back. He also has that fifth gear, though, and he showed both elements of his game on those two touchdown runs.
All right, so Stevens down 14-0. They come back here, though, on the kickoff after the Tervere touchdown. Javen Wirtz, very nice return here to set up a touchdown.
Yeah, Stevens has some talent this year. They've got some guys that can get it up and down the field. Again, depth, always a little bit of an issue for Stevens, but George Johnson, the left-handed quarterback, throws a nice ball.
That was a beauty to Alex Weaver. And Stevens right back in it at 14-7, but then it got a little out of hand as Alex Waltner will go to one of his very good receivers. This is Chase Grody for a touchdown.
Yeah, nice to see Grody get into the end zone, and they had such a great connection at the end of last year, so this could be the start of something good for them.
Lynx up 21-7. And then this is Braden Peterson with a touchdown to make it 28-7.
This Brandon team is a running team, by the way. We always think of them as a pass-first team, but they get it down on the ground, and they have a couple different backs they can go to, including this guy again.
Alex Wickersham had a couple of rushing touchdowns. That one made it 35-7. Chase Grody here with an interception on the Johnson throw right before the half. 35-7, Brandon Valley at halftime. Wickersham, Waltner score touchdowns in the second half. Rapid City comes back with touchdowns for Peyton Oxner and Michael Norman to make it respectable. 49-20 is the final, and the Lynx and the Raiders are both 2-2 on the season.
And just a quick note, Wickersham and Grody, both those guys are two-way players and two of the best two-way players in the state. Lynx use a lot of guys on both sides of the ball, and tonight they were just too much talent.
All right, Raiders host Roosevelt next week, and Brandon Valley-Harrisburg should be a very good game next week as well. In
Homecoming.
T, South Dakota, T area, off to a 3-0 start, Jandy, and they got off to a great start in this game. This is Adam Hine on the opening kickoff, 84 yards, touchdown.
You have so much energy in homecoming week, and to really put an exclamation point on it like this right out of the gate, you know that your head's in the right place. Great play.
Yeah, Hine had a big game, and then some T defense. Bad snap there. And the Titans take over in some pretty good field position there. And then Peyton Conrad to Jacob Rotter. Nice grab for a touchdown.
Yeah, I talked to Craig Klayberg this week, the T head coach, and he said it's so nice to have experience. They haven't had a ton of experience in the last couple seasons. This year, they just know what they're doing.
Dells was in the red zone several times tonight, but they could not stick one in the end zone as Carter Slykus there with an interception. And then deep in T area territory again, Adam Hine with the interception there to keep Dells out of the end zone.
You know, T's been on the other side of the score against Del Rapids a lot, so you know they enjoyed this one tonight.
And this was a crazy play there. Hine, they called it a fumble. He took it right out of the Dells player's hands and took it back for a touchdown. And T area goes on to win 19-0.
Yeah, nice win for the T area Titans. And defense is really the name of the game for these guys this year. Yes, they've got a couple tough games coming up with West Central and Madison, but a great 4-0 start for the Titans. They're looking to do big things this year in Class 11A, which has several good teams this year.
All right, Jandy. Looking for a Sioux Valley shot sheet here as Sioux Falls Christian taking on Sioux Valley.
Well, I know that's Sawyer Prinz, and I know that is their big receiver. I think that's Spencer Coolwine who came down with the first one. Look at that, the little hook and ladder that time and up the side of the field. Great start for Sioux Falls Christian, and their veteran quarterback, Sawyer Prinz. He did it with his feet a couple weeks ago. We saw him against Bridgewater Emory Ethan, but he can go up top. And
that's DJ Fykstra.
I think that's DJ Fykstra who had his second touchdown. I think I had him and Coolwine mixed up.
With a touchdown there. And then Christian will force a fumble here around midfield. That sets up another scoring drive for Christian. And then Prinz, this time to Tyler Van Horsen, who brings it down in some heavy traffic there. Two-point conversion goes. Sioux Falls Christian up 26-7 at this point. Damian Lucas, though, keeps it for Sioux Valley here. Ton of yardage on this run to get the Cossacks down in scoring position.
This is a running team, by the way. Against Elk Point Jefferson earlier this year, they ran for over 400 yards, a lot of it because of this quarterback, Damian Lucas.
Well, they turned it over on their previous drive, but Matt Larson punches one in here. Christian still leading 26-13 at that point, and that's how it ends up as Sioux Falls Christian. Again, Christian's in 11A, Sioux Valley in 11B, and Christian gets the win there, and the Chargers are 4-0 on the season.
By the way, Sioux Falls Christian had allowed just 7 points through their first three games of the season, so congratulations to the Cossacks. They put up 13. That's saying something at least, right?
All right, yeah, okay.
Saying something.
It is. The one game we did not have the highlights in from tonight, St. Thomas More did beat Lee Deadwood 66-16 tonight. St. Thomas More is a monster again.
Yeah, the offensive machine.
They are 4-0 on the season.
Led by Preston Arity and company, Jake Andert, all those guys. They just keep churning out these huge games. Another one tonight against the Gold Diggers.
All right, we will go to zone coverage when we come back. It's some post-game reaction from coaches and our reporters out in the field from West Fargo and Century and Roosevelt and O'Gorman, T area, Huron at Pier, everywhere else. Zone coverage coming up next. Welcome back to Varsity Sports Live. And our game of the week voting is done, Jason. And it will be Pier taking on Yankton.
Here in Yankton.
Next week, we will go out. We will record it.
Yankton desperately needs a win. Pier coming off of an overtime win will hit the road and play the same team that they lost to in the finals last year. So they'll be looking for a little revenge.
And then that game will air here on Midco Sports Network on Wednesday, September 28th, as Pier Yankton edges out the Harrisburg-Brandon Valley game there.
Now my favorite part of the show.
All right, this is called Zone Coverage. We'll throw it around and get some post-game reaction from coaches and players and reporters. Let's start with West Fargo. Cheyenne at West Fargo tonight. West Fargo wins that one 26-0.
Yeah, Jay Gibson and crew have really put on a show this year, and it'll be interesting to see just what Jay Gibson says about this big battle in West Fargo.
They did try to take Chase Tyken away. I would, too. He's a wonderful running back. I want to give credit to Cheyenne because I think that's the best defense by far that we've seen. They did a nice job of keeping Chase pretty much out of the game, but, you know, Andy threw the ball pretty well. Pistorius made a couple nice touchdown catches, I believe. We need to just keep improving. One thing we haven't done is we got about an iron 11. Cheyenne played 22 starters, you know, and they rotate people in, which is really neat. And I think that's why I'm so impressed with their defense, because it's not necessarily the best athletes. You know, we play the best athletes on defense, and then you got a guy like Metz that doesn't want to come off the field. Why should he come off the field? Just stay out there. So we have our job cut out for us. We need to develop backups. We had 3 injuries tonight, and people filled in, and I don't think anyone knew, and so that's what was really a good sign.
We got a scoop there. They had some injuries.
Did not realize, though, that West Fargo had that many guys playing on both sides of the football.
Yeah, like Brandon Metz, like he said, extremely great nose guard and also makes up a big part of that front line, and maybe the best two-way player in the state, Chase Tyken, the starting middle linebacker who doesn't like to come off the field himself, and of course we know what he can do on the offensive side of the ball.
All right, West Fargo is 4-0 on the season, and the Packers play Grand Forks Red River coming up next week.
They're going to keep rolling, by the way.
Minot was at Bismarck Century tonight, and a little bit of a surprise, I think, to some people. Minot beats Bismarck Century 28-10.
Yeah, they lost at home, and they didn't get their normal production from their passing game. Give credit to Minot and their DBs and what they did. And this was our game of the week this week, so you'll be able to watch the full game coming up on Wednesday. And our Joey Beltran was there to call the play-by-play, and he called in with this report.
Well, fellas, tonight we had a rematch from the North Dakota State Championship game last season where Bismarck Century beat Minot. However, tonight things would be drastically different as Minot would dominate Century from the start to the finish of this ball game. And you would really have to credit Creighton Rudolph of Minot. Their quarterback was unbelievable tonight. He looked like a young Tom Neiman out of Huron slanging the ball around. He had a terrific touchdown pass to Brett Lundy as time expired in the first half. Lundy goes up and makes a terrific high point catch over the D-back. Rudolph would continue his success in the second half, throwing for another touchdown. But the credit in this one has to go to those Minot linemen. The battle of the trenches was totally won by the big hog mollies of Minot tonight, and they won the battle of the trenches real well up front, both on the offensive and defensive sides of the ball, guys. And if they keep playing like this, especially up front, I don't see any team stopping Minot in North Dakota this season.
Ooh, bold words, buddy.
Creighton Rudolph should be honored, for one thing. I don't think I've ever seen Joey ball game without a hat on. It's a good picture of him. But
and I do
think
you sling the ball around, by the way?
We slung it a lot. Yeah. Jared Kranzer and I slung it around a lot here. Minot, though, do you like his assessment that they're going to roll maybe the rest of the season?
I can't wait to watch this game, because if they did physically dominate, they're going to need to physically dominate to play a team like West Fargo when they head out west. And Bismarck hasn't had the last say yet in the West, so a lot of season left for him to make a statement like that.
But that game is coming up, Minot-Bismarck Century. You can see it here on Midco Sports Network coming up this next Wednesday.
Wednesday at 9, yep.
All right, in South Dakota, Sioux Falls Roosevelt is neck and neck right now with Sioux Falls Washington as the top team in the big class. Roosevelt pulls away and beats Harrisburg 41-21.
I always have people ask me, because I rank Roosevelt number one and Washington's number one in the other poll. What makes Roosevelt so good? Why do you think they're better? Well, it's because they have that extra gear, and they showed that extra gear tonight. Let's hear from the Riders after their game.
We just have to be able to do both run and throw. We've got to run the ball a little bit better, but I think we got a good running back. Our offensive line is coming around. Now I think people are going to have to stop our passing game. I hope that we can come back with a little something on the ground.
Well, he says we didn't do much on the ground, but they didn't run the ball that much tonight. They went air first, and over 400 yards of passing, they got it done.
Torin Devericks, their quarterback, had three little short touchdown runs.
Yeah.
So they
Even had a touchdown. He carried it, I didn't see, but it was about 10 times is all. So.
All right. Roosevelt's 4-0. The Riders play at Rapid City Stevens next week. Washington, the other team we're talking about, pulled away to beat O'Gorman tonight. This game was tied 14-14 at halftime. Washington beats O'Gorman 35-14.
Yeah, and Chad Stadium talked about he doesn't have a consistent team. They're still young. They play not their best ball and still have big wins like this. So here was Chad Stadium's reaction after the game.
Yeah, we told him at halftime, we got to take care of mistakes. And one of our coaches, Coach Ferricks, told the guys, like, you know, you make mistakes, men own up to it, and they do something about it. And that's what we said we need to do. And, you know, Gorman played well. They really did. In that second quarter, they owned us. We gave them some opportunities, and they took advantage of it. And second half, we just said, you know what, we're going to pick up our tempo. We're going to just execute better. And we did. And I thought we made some plays when we needed to, and good things happened in the second half for us.
It was a good test for Washington. I mean, O'Gorman was a good test for them tonight halfway through the season.
A pumped up O'Gorman team coming off a big win on a homecoming night. Played well in the first half, just didn't have the guns, didn't have the depth to compete with Washington in the second half.
All right, Washington and Roosevelt will play each other the last game of the regular season. Looking forward to that. But Washington is 4-0 along with Sioux Falls Roosevelt. Huron was out at Pier tonight, and this game ends 34-33 in overtime. Pier wins it. Huron goes for two on the last play after they score, do not get it, and Pierre pulls out a one-point win.
Yeah, we didn't have cameras at this one, but it was such a good game. We called Jeff Duffy, who does the games for Huron football, and asked him, because he talked to Coach Schmitz after the game, about why they went for two. Here's what he said.
Oh, yeah, he definitely just, well, he said the kids actually made the call. We scored on our first play of the overtime after Pierre went ahead 34-27. We scored on a 10-yard run to make it 34-33. They sent the extra point unit out and took a timeout. And after the timeout, we went for two, ran an option, and we had kind of a low snap, and that kind of disrupted the timing of the play. And our quarterback, Kylan Hines, ended up getting tackled after about a gain of one, and that was the difference. But Coach Schmitz, when he came up afterward, he just said they called the timeout, and the kids came over and said, hey, we want to go for it. We want to go for the win. And he said, you know what, it's their team, so let's call the play, and they went for it.
Yeah, Coach Schmitz, by the way, has really gotten this – Huron numbers of the up in the last 4 years since he's taken over, and he's a player's coach. You let him decide.
Huron would have been 3-1, but they lost that game, so they're 2-2 on the season. Pierre goes to 2-2 now. Hylan Hines, four total touchdowns in that game for the Huron Tigers, their quarterback.
And Pierre came into the game with one rushing touchdown. Tonight they ran the ball a little bit better, and they stayed in it until the end and got the win. One
Pierre
point
over here on 34-33 in overtime. And finally, Jandley, Del Rapids at T Area tonight. T Area is still undefeated. And Adam Hine took the opening kickoff back for a touchdown. He had an interception in this game as T Area wins tonight. 19-0 was the final over Del Rapids. And here's Adam Hine after that game.
Well, we had Maka back. It was a big role. He had 23 and a half tackles, I guess, breaking our record. So, like, just those stops at the goal line and stuff, that just kept our momentum up also. Just made it better. That kick return, that was great. I loved it. But it just got our momentum going. We kept on going. That's what's up.
Well, he mentioned those goal line stands. Those were huge for T. And now they've got the seniors. They've got the experience. They flipped the script a little bit on Del Rapids, a team that they've had trouble against in the past few seasons.
All right, T area 4-0, and I'm looking for who they play next week, but I'm not sure. But anyway.
Well, they've got a tough schedule from here on out.
All right, T area at 4-0. That is zone coverage for tonight. There is a huge game in North Dakota on Saturday, Jandy. It's two of the undefeated teams left. West Fargo is 4-0. These are the other two undefeated teams so far.
Yeah.
Bismarck Legacy taking on Bismarck High, both 3-0 so far.
You heard that right. Bismarck Legacy undefeated, and I talked to their coach Chris Clements about their surprising start and what they have to do in this game against Bismarck.
You know, just we have to match their physicality, and we know it's going to be a physical game. The kids have to prepare for it. That's going to be a physical game. Gang tackle, you know, finish all the way through the whistle with your blocks, with your execution, and that's how we're approaching it.
They're ready.
Legacy's next three games, Bismarck High, Bismarck Century, and Minot. So
gets tough.
We'll see how they do. But Legacy and Bismarck High playing tomorrow in North Dakota. When we come back, the rundown, one big, huge, game-changing play from 15 ball games we were at tonight in the Dakotas.
Varsity Sports Live on Midco Sports Network is presented by Farmers Union Insurance Agency and South Dakota State University.
Welcome back to Varsity Sports Live. Let's get to the rundown, Jandley.
Yes, let's do it.
One big highlight from all the games we had cameras at tonight, starting with Minot at Bismarck Century, Creighton Rudolph to Brett Lundy.
Lundy's made some huge catches, none bigger than that one, sparking his team to victory.
Cheyenne at West Fargo, Andy Gravdahl and Joe Pistorius hooking it up.
I can't say anything else. Those two guys were the star of the night for the Packers.
Speaking of hooking it up, Stefan to Moody for Dickinson.
Huge win for them. By the way, only one loss. It was a close loss to Bismarck. Other than that, that's a perfect year for Dickinson.
Fargo South with a win at Red River. Another connection here. Pfeiffer to Tanner Beaton for a touchdown.
Yeah, and that was the touchdown they needed after that to take the lead and seal that win.
Cole Dauphinias with a touchdown run. He had a return touchdown as well. Bishop Ryan.
Watch out, undefeated in Class A, the Lions.
Over to Velva Sawyer. Larimore, 40-0 tonight. Royce Reculin.
Watch out, undefeated in Class A, the Polar Bears.
220 yards and three touchdowns there for him. Linton, HMB, Shiloh Christian tonight. This is Nick Pfaff to Bart Ogbu for a touchdown.
Nice catch. He's a good basketball player as well, but Shiloh Christian stays undefeated.
Catch of the night, Logan Utech for Sioux Falls, Washington on the touch. Or that wasn't a touchdown grab, but it kept a drive alive. Jaden Johansson puts it there, and Utech with the grab there as Washington wins. Torin Devericks with three touchdown runs tonight.
Two number one teams clashed, and the AAA team, Roosevelt, takes the win.
Corey Fichter banging it in for Lincoln as they beat Brookings.
Yeah, they needed a win to get back on track. Their second half was much better than their first half.
Alex Gower on a sneak here as Watertown pulls it out against Rapid City Central.
Yeah, Rapid City Central is not a pushover. They've had a really good defense this year. Good win for Watertown.
Another good quarterback receiver connection. Alex Waltner to Chase Grody.
Grody gets on the board, his first touchdown of the season. Waltner back on track.
T area had a big game from Adam Hine, but here's Peyton Conrad to Jacob Rotter.
Huge homecoming win, not just a win, but a shutout against a rival. Huge win for the Titans.
And then one last connection, another really good quarterback, Sawyer Prinz to DJ Feikstra.
DJ Feikstra can go up and get it. He showed that tonight with a couple touchdowns. That's nice that they have that connection through the air, not just on the ground. And Sioux Falls Christian, by the way, still undefeated in their class as well. A lot of undefeated teams left after playing some tough schedules on this fourth week.
All right, thanks again for voting in our Game of the Week voting. Again, it was Pierre Yankton, that game coming up next week. That was our winner tonight, got almost 250 votes. So we will have the Pierre Yankton game from next week. It'll run the following Wednesday night. If you want to see Minot and Bismarck Century, that game is coming up This coming Wednesday
night. The following week. Yep, just keep voting and keep watching.
All right, college football tomorrow on Midco Sports Network. We've got USD at UND up in Grand Forks. That game is at 4 o'clock, and it is right on Midco SN1. That is channel 622 in most areas. Cal Poly takes on South Dakota State in Brookings. That game is at 6 o'clock. It'll be on Midco Sports Network 2, channel 624. So both of those games going on tomorrow afternoon. Thanks for watching Varsity Sports Live. We'll be right back.